I'm going to put a link to their, oh, I'm being recorded. Perfect. I'm going to put a link to their flyer and program in the chat in case you're interested. Okay. So otherwise, now for the main event. Sorry about that, David. So for the main event, we're happy to have David Cohn here today talking about no credit and no gain, trade liberalization dynamics, production inputs, and financial development. House rules for those of you who are new is if you have a question, just go ahead and unmute yourself and break in like you would in a normal seminar. We'll have Fernando in the background also if you want to ask questions and Michael too in the chat room. You can ask questions there. And then we'll leave the stream open at the end for more more conversation and comments. Okay. So David, go ahead and take it away. You've got an hour.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Kim. So thank you for inviting us to present in this seminar. This is joint work with Fernando Libovici at the San Luis Fed and Michael Scoop at UBC. And this paper is part of our broader agenda on financial frictions and trade. And this is an agenda we started actually when we were students at NYU. And actually I was talking to Kim. The first paper started as a term project for the class that they were teaching with Mike Wu. So anyway, this is partly thanks to them actually that we're here today talking about this stuff. In this paper in particular, we're going to talk about the effect of financial development on trade liberalization. So one important channel that has been highlighted in literature is that trade liberalization allows for cheaper access to capital intermediate goods. And that allows firms to accumulate capital and leads to increases in productivity through different channels. And also it allows for an increase in TFP due to relocation resources. And these gains have been estimated to be significantly in the literature. Now, financial frictions may limit these gains. So we know from the literature that financial frictions limit capital accumulation and induce misallocation. This is partly closed economy literature. And then there is an open economy literature financial friction distort trade flows. And that's where my co-authors and I have been trying to contribute over the last few years. So in this paper, what we are going to ask, or what we're going to try to do, is to quantify the impact of financial development on the gains from cheaper access to capital and intermediate goods. I guess I have to, okay. So the question is, does financial development affect the gains from trivialization? What we're going to do to answer this question? First, we're going to document some cross-country dynamics in response to trade liberalization across different levels of financial development. That will give us some correlations. And then we're going to set up a dynamics general equilibrium model with the heterogeneous firms where there will be international trade subject to cost. So think about dynamic merits trade model. In addition, there will be financial frictions, model as collateral constraints, like in Boer and Moll. And then we'll have two representative sectors that will produce final goods, one consumption final good producer and one capital goods slash intermediate goods sectors producers, inputs producers. And then we're going to use this model, this pretty established model, to quantify the impact of trade liberalization. So we're going to be contrasting economies with low and high financial development and investigate the aggregate distribution of welfare effects. And this will be done mostly with input responses. And then at the end, I will show you, I hope I will have time to show you what we have been working over the last quite a few weeks now. That is to quantify the impact of Colombia's trade liberalization in the 1990s. Okay, so just a quick preview of the results. We find in the cross-country data that a higher increase in GDP, consumption, investment, and imports occurs in financially developed economies. And then the model will, following a decrease in tariff on capital goods, there will be the results will be consistent with this evidence, qualitatively at least, that financial development increases long-run effects modestly, but also speed up transition. And then due to this, financial development also increases welfare gains in the economy. And then we're going to look at the distributional effects and we'll find that irrespective of the level of financial development, the agents that benefit the most out of the trade liberalization are the most productive and the wealthy agents. Think about the exporters or the ones that are more productive. And then though in the financially developed economy, the gains are going to be more equally distributed if there is some difference across these two economies. And finally, regarding the exercise that we do for Colombia in 1991, there was a huge reaction in tariffs in that period. We find a reaction in tariff on capital goods. Due to those, and I have to show you exactly the experiment that we performed, but in 1996, 1.1 percentage point of GDP, of the increase in GDP, was due to deterioration. That's like almost 1/4 of the growth, of the overall growth between 1991 and 1996, okay? And then if Colombia had been financially developed at the time, and we mean by that, like had a level of credit over GDP, like in the average OECD economy, the GDP would have been an extra 1.4 percentage point higher by 1996, and that's an additional 12% growth over this period. And this is the 12 is a bit lower than 23, even though the 1.4 is higher than 1.1, because this takes into account the sequence, right? So the financial development kicks in a few years later. Okay, so that's for the preview of the results. So what we do is in the intersection of three strands of the literature. So one is the effect of trailerization on inputs and capital goods as different from the output tariffs. And this is mostly empirical literature, and there are also by now a few quantitative papers. Then there is a whole literature on quantitative evaluation of gains from trailerization with heterogeneous agent models. And many people here have contributed to that literature. And finally, the closest to us is the financial frictions and trailerization, or more broadly, financial frictions and trade. And they are the closest is this paper by Brooks and Dobbs that also look at the Colombian trailerization, and also our earlier papers that work with similar setups, but different questions. So in contrast to these studies, we study the interaction of finance with trailerization on capital and intermediate goods. We document differences in trailerization dynamics by financial development. And we use a dynamic model to quantify the impact of financial development for the Colombian trade liberalization. Okay. So that's the intro. So what I'm going to do now is, okay, let me show you the roadmap, the plan for today. I will show you some cross-country evidence, and the hope is that that's going to be motivating for the model that we're going to set up. Then I'm going to show you the model, and then I'm going to explain the quantitative analysis that we perform, the different details. We're going to look first at the aggregate effects, then the welfare and distributional effects. This will be mostly input responses. And then we're going to do this exercise for Colombia trailerization. The difference there is that we are going to add a few shocks that will allow us to, we're going to target some aggregate variables so that they look like what happened in Colombia looks like what happens in the model. Or what happens in the model looks like what happened in Colombia, actually. And then at the end, I would discuss something that is not part, so something that is related is partly validation. In our model, consumption tariff and capital or intermediate goods tariff have very different effects. So we're going to be looking at those. I will show you what the model predicts and also what the data, what we find in the data, at least comparing these two types of tariffs. But for most of the talk, I will focus on this and reaction of this tariff on capital and intermediate goods. Okay. So let me start with the data. So we want to investigate the effect of financial development on trade liberalization dynamics. What we do is we extend this paper by Esteban Diordal and Taylor. This is a Ristad paper in 2013. They look at the effects of trade liberalization. What we do here is we interact this with the role of financial development. And by financial development, we mean credit over GDP, basically. This is a standard measure in the literature since King and Levine in 1993. And we're going to partition countries into low and high financial development, below and above the median, for the average level of credit over GDP before the trailerization. And by trailerization, they are looking at what they call the great trailerization period. So it's basically in the 90s. So they will look, and we are going to do the same. For tariff before the 90s and after the 90s, we're going to focus on average tariff to maximize the number of countries. So we have some exercises then that we divide between capital tariff and consumption tariff. But for now, for the motivation, is average tariffs. So we have like 80 countries. And for each of these country groups, so high and low financial development, we estimate elasticity of key aggregates to changes in tariffs, right? And then we're going to plot the change of each variable relative to a 10 percentage point decline in average tariff. And that's what I'm going to show you. I don't know how to rewrite this. Okay. It is total credit to the private sector. Yes. Okay. Credit over GDP. So these are the figures. So the blue line, the blue solid lines are the high credit economies, the response of the high credit economies. The red lines are the response for the low credit economies. These are the coefficients of these regressions or near dummies, right? And high and low credit dummies. And what you can see here, if you focus on GDP, for example, on the GDP elasticity, you see that a decrease in 10 percentage points on tariff at the end, at 2004, it implied for the high credit economy a 20% increase in GDP and a half that increase for the low credit economy. And this is, the first few years look the same because we are detrending by a linear trend between 75 and 85. And of course, these are just correlations. There are many things going on. We will run some regressions to try to see how significant this is and try to control for some of these controls. But the main point here is to motivate some correlation that then we're going to use the model to make sense of them and to try to quantify how much is explained by the Trelew research. The same difference you can observe in consumption. Yes, sorry.
Just a quick question for a second. Like, consumption and investment grow by more than output. Is this something related to like you're taking out a different trend out of each one of these things? I would have expected like, you know, total GDP to be something like, you know, a weighted average of those two, since those are the two biggest chunks. Are you taking a different trend out of each series?
We are actually. So we did the same exercise for consumption or GDP and for investment or GDP. The one that falls is for the red line in consumption. That one, when you look at consumption or GDP, that one falls. But then the difference is because we're taking different trends.
Gotcha. Yes. Okay.
Yes. I will look the...
Just to clarify, yes, here, this is, I missed it. This is just, let's say, average GDP growth in these two bundles of countries, or you're conditioning on something else other than the two?
This is this is a regression, right, of GDP growth with respect to 1975, taking the linear trend between 75 and 85. In response, so these are the coefficients that we're plotting in response to the decrease to the year dummy. So it is exactly what we say, an average change for all these countries, and we are separating in high credit and low credit, interacting with these year dummies, and then in the regression we're trying to control for some extra stuff that I'm going to show you next, but not here, not in the figure.
So I should interpret this as the countries that have are financially developed grow more than the countries that are not financially developed?
They grew more with respect to the trend 75-85 during the period of trailization for many things. This could have happened for many things. I agree. Yes. Yes, that's exactly what it is. So you observe larger increase in GDP, consumption, investment, and imports, export behave similarly. So what we do here, trying to take into account some of these controls. Okay, first, we do a simple regression. This is a cross-sectional regression to see how significant this is. So these are 80 countries. This is the average change in GDP with respect to 1975, before, after and before. So we're taking two periods, 1990 to 2004. That's the average growth after 1990 and the average growth before. We do the change, that's the change in log GDP, that's the dependent variable. And we regress that on the change in tariff, the change in tariff interacted by the high credit dummy and a high credit dummy, okay? And the yellow line there, it means that most of these guys are significant, but as Dorian was saying, there might be many things going on. We try to do some work. Let me show you some of the stuff that we do. So we control for an institutional index. This is from the Economic Freedom of the World. They have an index of legal and property rights index. This is a dummy. So we interact the change in tariff with that dummy. And this interaction keeps being significant. We have done it also with GDP per capita, and it's still significant. But of course, there might be many things going on. It's not just that the financial developed economy might respond might grow more, but also they might respond more to a trade liberalization for the same reasons that they are financially developed, right? So we take this as a correlation.
David, I know yes. that the net exports to GDP is not showing up as significantly, but this is reminding me of this literature at the time following these trade liberalizations on the timing of reforms of the Washington consensus reforms. And the recommendation that came out of that literature was that you shouldn't liberalize to capital before liberalizing to trade, because that could lead to a lot of debt accumulation and eventually a crisis. So these countries that are more financially developed, are they more liberalized to capital? Did they experience also some instability due to a bigger accumulation of debt, which I don't even know if it's significant or not. Apparently net exports is not significant, but can you speak a little bit to that literature and the relation?
Okay, so Cecilia, I will have more to tell you. Let me show you how the model behaves, and the model will replicate some of that. And it's exactly because of that, because there will be higher increase in consumption investments, like a consumption investment boom will be higher in these financially developed economies. And that's something like what happened in Colombia, actually. So I can talk more
Colombia,
about that.
But in Colombia, it didn't lead to a big crisis. In other countries, it may have, right?
So it led to a crisis
check that in
1998, right? Colombia, in other Latin American countries, in 1998, after the Asian crisis, they had like a sudden stop.
The exchange rate crisis, yeah.
Yes. So, I agree. So this, at least this figure, if you take it like a nominal value, this means that imports increase by more in these countries, and then they lead to a higher,
larger depreciation.
Yes.
Yeah.
And we've been looking, I don't remember exactly the result, but we look a bit at what happened with the real exchange rate. But let me talk more about the model. The model will generate some of these dynamics.
Okay.
Then we can.
Or at least in Brazil is a sovereign debt default and Argentina. Yes. So it might be nice to look at some crisis variables, even if it's only in an appendix.
I see. Cool. Thank you. So what this country events suggest, cross-country events suggest that in response to trade liberalization, there is higher increase in GDP, consumption, investment, and imports among financially developed economies. This is robust to control for institutional economic development, but it's only so much that we can do with, first, so few countries that we have, and second, so many things that were going on at the same time, because like Colombia, many of these countries were performing like other type of reform. They were also financially liberalizing, like Cecilia was saying, and they were reducing other type of trade barriers and so on, right? So we'll take it to the model to quantify these effects in this quantitative model.
David, before you go to the model, with those movements in GDP, is it really coming from like productivity, or is it coming from labor force, you know, growth? Do you have some? It didn't look like it because because investment's really not growing that much, so it can't really be capital deepening. So is it efficiency, or is it, some labor supply component?
Because I know we discussed this before, but we haven't looked at that yet.
I
think by investment, it is growing more for this, at least, I mean, if you take it, these figures.
It's not that much more, and the capital stock is 1/3, and it takes a lot of investment for it to really, you know, be capital deepening. So, I mean, you could
I
just,
see what you mean.
I mean, the first thing would be look at L and then like Z, something else to put in the appendix.
I know we need to do that. I'm sorry we haven't done it yet. Thanks. Thank you. Let me see. Okay, I'm doing fine. So, and we focus on reaction in tariff on capital and intermediate goods, first, because these are directly affected by financial frictions, and second, there are very different effects between consumption and capital goods tariffs, both in the data and the model. But I will show you this to in the end, because most of my presentation will be about these capital tariffs, right? So I didn't want to get stuck there. So what's the model? We have a small open economy, so interest rate will be given. The main agents here in the economy will be a unit measure of guys that can be either entrepreneurs or workers. they produce a domestic variety and decide how much to sell domestically and how much to sell abroad. Each of these guys owns a firm, right? And they are both, right? Entrepreneurs and workers. It's not that they can choose here. And there will be also sectoral good producers that will aggregate these varieties to produce either a consumption good or an investment good. They will aggregate these domestic varieties and some imported varieties. And then there will be the rest of the world to which these entrepreneurs will be selling their product also, like exports. And the investment goods, so I realize that we're calling it here like investment goods, capital goods, or they are all the same. And they can be used as intermediate inputs in production, so in the production of these entrepreneurs, and also to build up capital. The preferences of these guys are standard CRRA preferences, and each of these guys owns a firm, and each of these firms produces a differentiated domestic variety, this monopolistic competition. And the idiosyncratic production function has an idiosyncratic productivity shock C, capital K, labor N, and materials M. That this will come from the investment goods. And then the productivity will follow an R1 process. These goods are going to be sold to a consumption and capital good producer and to the rest of the world. And the export will be subject to fixed costs and potentially to variable trade costs, tau greater than or equal than one. These guys will accumulate capital internally, and also they will supply one unit of labor in elastic. Okay? Then there will be one period risk-free bonds. Interest rate will be given internationally. So the problem of these guys, we can divide in a static and a dynamic problem. So an entrepreneur with states with capital K, debt D, and productivity C will choose prices, quantities, labor, material, and where to export or not to maximize the profits that depend on capital and C and productivity. And these are the domestic sales, PH and YH, H because of home, the foreign sales, PF, YF, times the real exchange rate, Psi, and E is an indicator, is equal to one if they decide to export, zero if not. And they pay for the labor, for the materials at price PK, that could be different than one. And then they pay for the fixed costs that here are in terms of labor. And that they do, they do subject, they maximize this profit subject to a production function. So the production they use for the domestic production, the foreign, and the production from the foreign market. And then it's subject to these demands from the final good producer of consumption capital, and from the foreign demand that could be subject to an export tariff or a foreign tariff. And then there is also a dynamic decision, so a consumption saving decision, how much to consume, how much to save assets, right? AT plus one, and they have to repay their debt D, and they do that with their wage, they do that with the undepreciated capital and their profits. And then there is a lump sum transfer that these are the tariff inputs, these are the tariff to the goods that are going to be rebated lump sum to these guys. Now, like in our literature of financial friction, what we assume is that these guys observe the future productivity, the idiosyncratic productivity, and then they choose how to allocate their net worth between capital and debt. Or another way of saying this is that they will choose how to finance their capital, PK times K, between their internal net worth, A, and their debt, D. And D, the debt will be subject to a borrowing constraint. So they will be able to borrow up to a fraction, theta, or a multiple of their value of their capital, the capital they choose to A for tomorrow, PK times K. So the PK times K appears in these two restrictions. So basically, and the D, so we can write this as one constraint. So this means that the capital is constrained by the value of by the asset that each of these firms have, right? So this is an idiosyncratic state variable. And the theta here appears here. So if it has to be less than one plus R, if it's one plus R or more, this is financially constrained, the economy. And the other thing to notice how this restriction is that when the tariff to the capital good goes down, the price of capital will go down. So this will relax the borrowing constraint because the capital will become cheaper. Okay, and that's basically the problem of this economy. And we can, with this timing assumption that we assume and our papers have assumed, we can write all this problem in terms of two state variables, the net worth and the productivity, basically. So these are the main engines in the economy. You stop me if there are questions. And then there are concerns.
Sorry, can I just stop you one bit? I'm trying to sort of fit this together with So I think about a Niagara world where, you know, we get this sort of over accumulation of capital, but the constraint is different. How does that, you know, how does this relate to that?
So these guys won't be able to accumulate as much capital as they want. And then, so all these models have so the restriction here is that you need this, like the beta to be low for these guys to be, to not accumulate enough assets so that they are not constrained. So I think that might be going to what you have in mind.
Okay, so these guys have to be super impatient for this to work.
They have to be impatient, or what some of our papers have assumed is that they have some impatience and also they have a probability of dying, right? So we're making it simpler here. So we have a low beta. I will show you. We are going to calibrate to some statistic in the data. Yeah, but that's true. They have to be impatient. Because if not, they accumulate enough net worth, they are not borrowing constrained. Okay. Okay.
David, the part here that for me is always tricky is the following. So if we think about Mendoza 2010, you have the opposite correlation on the price of capital and the financial friction. Because here is good news that the price of capital collapses. But in a model like Mendoza 2010, that's bad news. And in some sense, during a financial crisis, if we expect that more people are going to be constrained, that's exactly the moment where the price of the assets go down. So how do we understand a financial crisis, for example, on this context?
So let me start first. I agree that the borrowing constraint is different to what those papers have. So we don't have a financial accelerator here. So in those papers, the price of capital, so it has two effects, the price of capital. You can see here the effect in the, when you put the two constraints here, you can see where that effect would be, right? If the price of capital goes down, then you can borrow less. That's what this paper have. Here also, you have that it makes capital cheaper, right? And since you have this extra asset that is the net worth, that's what helps you to. So basically, it's not the value of this asset that goes down, right? So I think that would be closer if you have A here times the price of whatever you say. But here it has two effects, the price of capital. It makes it capital cheaper, and also it makes that you can borrow less for the same capital because it's valuable more. And that effect is the only one that is in those papers.
Sorry, maybe to make it clear here, so there's a capital good, but that's not the capital stock, which is K.
No, it is a capital stock, it's a capital good, but there is a net worth. So you accumulate some savings that you allocate then between capital and debt or bonds, if you want, right? So that A is how much you save. You save in some type of wealth. And then you decide how to allocate it between capital and bonds. And the constraint is on the debt, is on capital, right? So it tells you, you can borrow up to a multiple of the value of the capital.
So there's the price. I thought we were talking about the price of investment, but here you can eat the capital. So the price of investment and the price of capital are the same.
They are the same, yes. Yes. But I agree with what Felipe was saying, that this is a slightly different effect that you have like in a Mendoza typical paper or Margaret Garland's paper. So then you have the consumption group process and the capital intermediate group process. This guy, we aggregate this domestic variety.
Let's keep it going at this.
Yeah.
So you could have done different things with the constraints. That's the way I kind of take this whole discussion. And so kind of like, why? I mean, I've seen this so much, but why this constraint? Why not a different one? Does it matter for how we think about your results or the inefficiency, how the inefficiency is going to interact with the trade liberalization, you know? Or you could just pun, but I think that's an interesting kind of question.
Yeah, okay. So a general point, the effects will depend on the type of borrowing constraint that you put. I think this is the point of this paper by Brooks and Dovey, right? So if you have a forward-looking constraint, then the effect will be very different than a backward-looking constraint. this type of constraint to us, it makes sense. And we, I mean, there are many papers that use something like this, and in particular, this literature, I think, is similar to Vera do, to what Ben Moll does. So I think for us, it was kind of a standard, but it's true that this may have to take a new look, but this is doesn't have this effect of financial accelerator flavor. But depending on the type of, so we actually, we recently wrote like a survey about this literature, and depending on the type of Warren constraint, we discussed this there, and we have it might have different effects. To us, this is pretty standard, it makes sense, but I think that's, but maybe we can talk more at the end about this. I think it's an interesting point, and we can go back to this if you want. So this final good producer, there is consumption good producer, there is a capital intermediate good producers. These guys will aggregate domestic varieties and foreign varieties. They will be, we're going to estimate this, the fraction of imports there. They will have a omega C, omega K, there will be a fraction of imports, and they will be subject to different tariffs. And in the XL, we're going to sometimes be decreasing both, sometimes we'll be decreasing only the tau K, right? And these goods were going to be used as investment, as intermediate inputs of production. Then there are going to be the tariffs that are rebate lump sum. And then the rest of the world, they supply foreign varieties. This at the given prices, PM and PMC and PMK, we'll take it as given. There is an exogenous CS demand, and the interest rate is given.
Just to hang on here. So yes. I have these varieties, and is it the same aggregator for consumption and capital?
This might be useful. It's the same aggregator, but the omega might be different, right? Omega C and omega K. So that if the omega is different, that might mean, and they have different taus, right? But the PK might be different than one because of this.
Right, but so this different taus is basically distorting the consumption investment margin in this economy in a particular way. And so if you just change these taus differentially, it's like you're changing that distortion directly.
That's correct. And that's why, for example, when the tau K goes down, the PK, that is the relative price between these two goods, is going to go down. Yeah, exactly.
Just a related point is that is omega K supposed to capture differences in comparative advantage between consumption and capital goods that Colombia in your later application has a comparative disadvantage in producing capital goods? Is omega K kind of a reduced form way of getting at that?
I think you're right. What we're going to do then is try to match both the share of imports and the share of imports that is from consumption goods. And that's how we're going to discipline these two parameters. The tariff will take as given at the level that they had that we observed they had in previous to the trade liberalization, and then we are going to move it like. But the omegas we're going to discipline that way.
Something a bit back to a point that Dorian was raising before. So here the marginal price of investment and capital is the same because you don't have adjustment costs on investment. But that's not the case between consumption and capital. So basically, if we think about the Tobin skew between how you transform consumption goods in capital goods, here is not one-to-one because of this specificity in imported inputs. No?
I agree totally with what you just said. Yeah, and we don't have adjustment cost to investment. We do have financial friction that kind of act like adjustment cost, right? So we didn't want to mix those two, basically, to isolate the effect of financial friction.
Hey, David, I just missed something on like the how you're closing the whole GE and how you're thinking about the experiment. This is like a unilateral cut in tariffs.
So we'll do all type of experiment. The one I want to show is a unilateral decrease in tau K.
And then you're going to think about like, how is that going to feed into the terms of trade? Usually when you have a unilateral change in your tariffs, it's going to kind of lower the price of your goods.
There will be a depreciation.
Are you guys kind of killing that in the way that you've set up the small open economy?
No, that's going to happen. So there will be a real depreciation because of that.
Okay.
Yes, and then to match what happened in Colombia, we're going to look at other shocks as well.
Okay.
But right. From the tau K, there will be a real depreciation because exactly what you said, it will become cheaper, the consumption good, the final consumption good.
Yeah, I just missed it in the model, but thanks. Thanks for clarifying.
So and then you can define competitive equilibrium. The only thing I want to show you here is that there are three key prices here, real wages, the real exchange rate side, and the price PK, the price of capital. All those are in terms of the price of the final consumption good, basically. Okay. So we're getting to the quantitative analysis. The model is pretty stylized. We have the caveats that we've been discussing, but we're going to take it seriously and we're going to try to discipline with the data. And first, I'm going to show you some input responses. What I mean by this, we're going to consider trade liberalizations in Colombia in 1988, 1992. It was pretty fast, the liberalization. I can show you the figure. But there was a large drop in import tariff on capital intermediates. Tariff, the simple average of tariffs, that's what we could look at the different figure, but they went from 32% to 12%. And proportionally, this 20 percentage point of decrease was similar, actually, between consumption and capital goods, if you divide it that way. And then they stay low for a few years. And in our model, agents will learn about this change in tariff once capital has been chosen. They might be able to decide immediately if they want to export more or less, to hire more labor or not, or more or less, but the capital will be given when this happens.
Hey, David, are you gonna model like the actual dynamics of trade policy? The tariffs in Colombia were expected to like phase out, and then the economy went into like recession and then they kind of accelerated these tariffs. Are you gonna think about that timing, or you just take it as once and for all and kind of not really worry too much about the first couple of years?
So we thought a lot about this. So it's true. So what happened is that they were going to go slowly. Then there was Cesar Gaviria, the president, and he decided it wasn't having the effect that they hoped so. So in between 1990 and 1991, they slashed tariff. For us, it looked a lot like one time. And the advantage of that is that it mixes a bit. It's like a not trade-off, but it's like a little bit of everything. It helps us understand very simple what's going on in a simple way. But the only thing we've done, I can show you at the end, is that we thought, what if it was expected change, right? Yeah. But other than that, we haven't played a lot with that.
Yeah, I mean, there's just gonna be a force in the model if you kind of tell them the tariffs are gonna go down more in the future for capital goods, that people are gonna kind of delay investment for until the tariffs actually go down. So it just, if you're kind of thinking about the first couple of years, that's kind of how it's gonna kind of play out in a standard model.
I see. So the other thing about us is that we don't have adjustment. So again, we have financial freedom, but we don't have adjustment costs. So there are many funny things that might be going on if we put like a complicated dynamic of tariffs. So anyway, this helps in that direction.
Okay.
So we calibrate the model to match moments from Colombian plant level data between 82 and 88. This is annual manufacturing survey plus 10 workers. And then, and this is similar to what our papers have done, Daniel Xu with Marcela Slava and so on. And George has a paper also about the Colombian liberalization. And then we study aggregate and distribution effects of liberalization. We are going to contrast the baseline economy, Colombia, let's say, credit over GDP of 24% of the time, with the financially developed economy, that is the OECD economy. But how we think about this is that we calibrate to the same targets, but we have different parameters across the two economies. So we calibrate those separately. It's like two Colombias, one with high theta. So we observe what happened for the moments in Colombia, and we try to match that with low theta, and a high theta, basically. And even though I'm like short of time, I will say very little about but we take some parameters as given, and then we calibrate like some are standard targets, share of export, export size premium, R1 of total size. But then what I told you before, the omegas to the share of imports and imports over GDP, and then the theta to credit over GDP, and the beta, and this is a question I got from Dorian before, is 0.81. This is similar to having a beta of 0.9, is low anyway, times 10% probability of dying. This is usually in our paper. But we match the beta to match the net exports over GDP, right? Basically the savings of the economy in terms of GDP. And then for the financial developed economy, we recalibrate for a higher credit over GDP, but we kept the beta fixed. Why? Because we want to compare welfare, and then it's useful to have the same beta. But anyway, so we can improve some of these, but let me go fast because, so I want to have some time to show you some results. So when there is a decrease in tau K, decreases the cost of capital intermediates, this induces capital allocation, relaxes the borrowing constraint here. And then capital producer will relocate to imported varieties. Consumer producer will relocate to domestic varieties that are cheaper because their imported varieties didn't become cheaper. And this will have positive direct effects. And this will be expansion in the economy. And there will be also some indirect effects to other prices. So there will be a real depreciation due to a lower cost of production, like a supply shock, that benefits exporters. And then real wages will go up because there will be higher demand for labor. And in the economy with financial friction, there will be a gradual adjustment. But this, yeah, this is something I'm going to show you next. So let's start comparing steady states. If you take the baseline economy, you compare the initial steady state and the final steady state, there is as a response to a decrease in tau k of 20 percentage points, there is an increase of real GDP of 2.6%, capital increases, consumption increases, real export increase. Why? Because the price of capital goes down, real wages go up, right? And there is a real exchange rate. If we do the same in the financially developed Colombia or the financially developed economy, we observe that there is a modest increase, right, in these variables. Real GDP, capital and consumption increase a bit more, export by less. Why? Because here there is the firms can take more advantage of the decreasing tariff. They can invest more. There is a higher increase in the domestic demand, basically, like a wealth effect. And then the price of the domestic final consumption good increases by more. So the real exchange rate increases by less, and that implies that the real exports increase by less. Or not that implies, there is no causality, they move to air. But when you look at the trade realization, there is other difference that jumps up, that real GDP, capital, and consumption, even though they go to different levels, also the speed of conversion is faster in the financially developed economy, right? So they increase slowly, both real GDP, capital, and consumption increase slowly. Real export increase by more, like I explained in the other economy, and they increase pretty fast. Why? Because this is something that we documented in previous paper, that there is some reallocation here. So the firms here, the financial friction affect the total production, but you can reallocate from the domestic market to a foreign market. So if a firm is financially constrained, they can sell more abroad and less domestic. And there's nothing that affects that. If you look at the speed of conversion, like you divide by the final steady state, then you find that you can see clearly that there is a difference in the speed of convergence. Okay.
David, one question.
Yes.
When you're going to look at welfare, are you going to decompose the effects between the speed of the transition and the final steady state? How much of the welfare, for example, is going to come from the fact that these economies have different steady states?
I can show you. We'll do that.
Okay, because so just not to interrupt you again. So I'm asking that because we know that you could eliminate the final effect if you use any of the tricks to make the small open economy stationary. If you have a bond holding cost, that's going to get you to the same steady state, and the only benefits are going to be on the speeding up of the transition.
I see. I think we can talk more later, but let me show you the results. I see. Okay, so there is also a difference in the speed of convergence. So after 10 periods, for example, GDP, capital, and consumption cover 87, 85, and 75% of the long-run chance. So take GDP, for example, almost 90%. In the baseline economy, it's only 70% of the total change, right? So this is consistent with the cross-country evidence. And what we do next, we observe welfare. And all this that we're doing is with these input responses. Then we are going to do the extra exercise I talked to you about. I think I will have time to show you, and I want to spend some time there.
Sorry, one thing. Are you going to show us what happens to the current account at any point?
I will for Colombia. I have it for, but I didn't. So do I have it here? I have it here, but I show you for Colombia, for the other experiment. I'm sorry. We have it. I should have shown you. Okay. Sorry. Maybe I have it not in the presentation, but and then at the end I can show you. But I show you what happens in Colombia in the other experiment. Okay. The welfare and distribution effects. We use a consumption equivalent welfare measure. It's pretty standard. So we compare the value of a function, the value function of an entrepreneur, if the trade realization does not occur, with respect to the value of the entrepreneur, the trade realization occurs, how much you have to give to this guy for him to be indifferent. We do it at the aggregate welfare, and then we do it by groups of agents to compare how the distribution effects act. And we do this like what Felipe was suggesting. We look first at scaling the transition. So imagine that you jump directly from the first state to the second state. So there is a big increase in welfare, both in the base and financially developed. And I would say that the gains are mostly, and this like reflect the difference in consumption between state. There were some differences that were not very large, right? The difference is because they have different states. But then when you include the transition, so we didn't do, Felipe, like a perfect decomposition, but this speaks to what you were asking before. You see that there is a larger welfare gain in the financially developed economy than in the baseline economy, like 6 times larger. And both of them are lower because the increase in consumption in these economies is slow in both of them, actually, in the financially developed as well, right? But the transition is lower in the baseline economy, okay? Okay, so what we do next, and we do like in the paper, we have like different decompositions, but let me show you like a flavor of these results. We look at the distribution effects. On the left is the baseline, on the right is the financially developed. On the baseline, there are winners and some losers, a few losers. In the financially developed, they are all winners. What do I want to highlight that here? So first, if you look at exporters, you look at wealthy that are the top 10% of the agents here. You look at the in terms of assets. You look at entrepreneurs that we define entrepreneurs and workers here by the guys that use more than 1 unit of labor. So they use more than their supply of labor. And workers are the ones that use in the production less than 1 unit of labor. So all the export entrepreneurs wealthy, they benefit by more. That's one difference. The second difference is that if you compare the left column with the right column, for example, take the exporters versus non-exporters. On the left is 1 divided by 0.16 is like 6 times larger exporters. On the right is like 1.5, a bit more than 1.5. The same happens with entrepreneurs and workers and wealthy and poor. So there are less differences between these two agents in the second economy. This is in terms of welfare, right? And second, then we do that, what we do in the paper, we decompose from where these welfare gains are coming. So we do a set of partial equilibrium exercise. And the thing is that real wages in the financially developed economy increase by more, and they help more to redistribute these benefits from the rich agents to the poor agents. That's what's in the back of these results, let's say. Okay. So I'm excited to show you what we do next because we've been working a lot in this, but I will be happy to have feedback on this because, so basically we want to quantify the effect of the trade realization in Colombia. We could have done this in different ways. For the financially developed economy, we had to design an experiment because we don't observe like the counterfactual. We could have looked at other country and calibrate. Looking at Colombia help us because we have the micro data to estimate and discipline the model, right? So we're going to try to answer 2 questions. One is how important was the impact of trade realization in Colombia? The second one is how much higher would have been the effect of the trade realization if Colombia was financially there. Okay. So how we thought this experiment, these are the same economics I was talking about. We calibrated those to the micro data in Colombia. I show you already the calibration very quickly, but I show it to you. And then we consider trade realizations in Colombia. In Colombia, all tariffs went down. So we decreased both tau K and tau C from 0.32 to 0.12. Okay. And what we do now, different than before, is that we choose a set of 3 shocks for the first 4 years. That's what we managed to do so far, to match real GDP, investment over GDP, and consumption over GDP in the data, okay? And I'll show you the results in a second. But so what is important here? So what are these shocks first? These shocks are an aggregate productivity shock that affects in addition to the idiosyncratic productivity shock, to all firms the same way. That will help us with real GDP. Investment over GDP will have a decrease in real interest rate. And then for consumption over GDP, we have to come up with a demand shock. It's like an endowment shock. Let me show you exactly what we do. So that zeta there in the borrowing constraint, that's what we do. We have this red shock here. That Greek letter is zeta. And then we're going to shock that. We're going to have an increase in that. And the way we think about that is like this exogenous foreign inflow that came to all Latin America at the time, for foreign reasons, like there were a lot of liquidity in the world, and will help us match what Dorian was worried about is that the net exports or GDP base, there will be a trade deficit, important trade deficit, because it helped us with consumption or GDP. The other shocks didn't help us with consumption or GDP. Okay, that's one thing. And the other thing is that we will have two Colombias, one baseline and one financially developed. So we choose the shock separately for both economies. So real GDP, investment or GDP, and consumption or GDP will look the same across. If we manage to calibrate very good, we do a good job, but we're still working. But they will look the same across these two economies, okay? The aggregate series. But the shocks are different in these two economies because these are different economies. So the decrease in the real interest rate in particular would have much larger effects in the high theta economy. So then we're going to do this. How? I'm going to show you three sets of figures. One is contrast the base economy with the data to show you that we do a decent job matching the data. Second, the base economy with the economy without the reaction in tau k, because we've been focusing on this reaction in tau k. So this is the effect of the trailways of the reaction on input tariffs. And then the base economy versus the financially developed economy. And that's the effect of financial development on the trailway research.
David, let me just understand what you've just said about the comparison, the last bullet point on the baseline economy versus the financially developed. You're not just going to relax a capital constraint on the, an alternative exercise would be take the baseline economy, reduce tau k, and reduce the capital constraint, right? To relax the capital constraints. But you chose to reestimate the model instead of doing that counterfactual. Why did you choose that approach?
Sure. So you're right. I mean, there are different ways of doing this, and we're planning to do an exercise like what you had in mind. And that probably will help us also with having putting less weight in the decrease in real interest rates. So we're not increasing theta over the transition. We're comparing two economies with different thetas, basically, and different shocks. Why we chose to do it that way? Because we wanted to see the effect, like isolate the effect of the trade realization. Like the other exercise, and I think it's a very interesting exercise, we always get asked about this, is like comparing the effect of the trade realization and financial development over time. But what we have in our back of our minds, like when we designed this experiment, we were thinking, look, how a trade realization will impact if you have an economy with low credit or GDP and an economy with high credit or GDP. Keep it fixed. We want to isolate the effect of a trade realization, right? But I think it's super interesting exercise to do, and we're planning to do it actually. So just we didn't have time, and it's a lot of like a lot of stuff that is already here.
It's fine. The only reason why I mentioned it, and I don't want to hold you too much, is because if Colombia were financially developed, then probably the investment to GDP ratio and all these other variables to which you're matching the model to the data would be different, right? So I have a hard time interpreting the exercise, but you know, come on.
No, I agree, but let me tell you how we thought about it. No, you're totally right. But this is a mixture, like take it to the data. And for that, the only thing we can see is the first two points, right? The effect of the trade recession in Colombia. But then we wanted to use the same model to measure the effect of financial development on trade realization. But it's true, I mean, Colombia wouldn't look like that. So maybe it would make more sense to look at whatever, Japan. But Japan in the 90s was a problem, but some other country that went through a trade realization has high debt over GDP. This is a way for us to capture like this is a counterfactual. The other one is more factual. Like I think Joe, like he pushes more on that direction, but this one is more a counterfactual, like a ideal exercise to try to see, okay, what would be the exercise of having high debt? And for that, it makes some sense, but of course you can think of different exercises. Yeah.
Sorry to hold you up more on this, but it seems like, you know, one policy experiment you think of is, you know, you change the theta. I mean, I don't know what you do to change the theta. And yeah. Suppose I change it at different points in this transition, you know, what does that do? That seems like, you know, going back to Cecilia's point, a more, I don't know, sort of compelling, that's the question. How do I sequence my reforms?
I think that's okay. So I think that's also an interesting question. How you sequence your reform? I think that's kind of, this is more focused for us. Like we've been talking about realization. We want to see, but I agree. I mean, I don't have anything about that. I'm just saying that it's a different question. But we were planning to do something like that also, because I think it's a complementary question to what we're doing here. But the sequences of the sequencing of the reforms, I think it's a super interesting question. It always comes up. It's, I think, yeah, that's all I want to say. Okay, let me show you some results. This is what we did. I mean, so on the top line, you have real GDP, consumption over GDP, the change with respect to 1991, and the investment over GDP for the data and the model. Up to 1995, we are calibrating this. It doesn't look perfect because we still have some work to do. So basically, each time we need to recompute the prices for actually we're solving for 40 periods, but I'm showing you this because this is what we can compare in the data. Remember, the Colombia in 1998 had a crisis, so that would be a totally different story. But basically, I think we do a decent job, even for 1986, that we're not trying too much. That's why GDP, there is a difference. And then the net export of GDP, they also look good. So the trade dynamics implies it's close to data, but in part because we're matching consumption, investment, and real GDP, right? So it's the difference. Imports increase in our GDP, like in the data, a little more. And export of GDP in the data decrease, right, in the first few years. If you look at the longer trend, like George does with the paper of his with Avila, then there is an increase in export of GDP. But the first few years, actually, of export of GDP, they went down. They didn't increase much. So the model captures some of these dynamics. This slide what is trying to convey is that this is a model, simple model, but kind of looks like in the data, right? And to this model, what we're going to do is this blue line, we're going to examine the effect of the reaction in tau k. And that's the red line here, okay? So let me start with real GDP. Real GDP here, the effect of the red line, this is the 1.1 difference at 1986 that I was talking about in the beginning, right? GDP is higher 1.1, but the difference is all over the sequence. So if you compute the area between the blue line and the red line divided by the red line, that's like 23% I was talking about. When you look at consumption over the GDP, it falls due to the trailerization, but doesn't mean that consumption falls. I'm not showing you here, but I have it in the background. Consumption actually increases, but increases less than GDP, right? As effect of trailerization. Investment increases as much as GDP. That's why investment over GDP looks the same with and without the decrease in tau k. Exports over GDP, imports over GDP, both increase because of the tau k. So the increase is the difference between the blue line and the red line here. And net export of GDP, because of the trailerization, also increases a little bit, okay? But the exercise we reproduce with the same shocks, but we shut down the tau k. So we didn't decrease tau k in this experiment. Tau c is going down because we're focusing here on the effect only of tau k, right? And that's the net exports for GDP as effect of the trailerization. And finally, and I think I have 1 minute to show you this, but I don't want to hold you more time than necessary. This is the effect of financial development. So let me start with real GDP. So because of financial development, real GDP increases an extra 1.4 percentage points, but it's only since 1994, okay? So how is this experiment? We take the blue line, we take the red line, sorry, here, and we add up there the effect of the trailerization in what we call the financially developed economy, right? But I think these two lines just convey the quantitative results from that exercise. That is, what we interpret this is like, if Colombia had been financially developed in that sense, sure, you have been more investment or GDP and so on, but that means that we'll be capturing the effect of the financial development in other aggregate variables as well. And here, like we're isolating that effect. That's how we thought about this, but there are different ways of doing this. Consumption also increases, but increases the same as GDP, so consumption of GDP looks the same. Investment over GDP increases, so that means that investment increases more than GDP, and imports over GDP increase, and there is a larger, and here what I think I told Dorian back a few minutes earlier, is that in the financially developed economy, there is a larger trade deficit because of the financial development. There's a larger increase in investment, a larger increase in imports, okay?
But the effect on welfare is minimal, right? if we look at consumption to GDP, there is no change practically.
Yeah, consumption of GDP doesn't change, right? So as much as if welfare is has a direct relation with consumption of GDP, there won't be much effect there. I agree. We haven't computed that for this exercise. We haven't done it so far.
No, but it could have still, Cecilia, because they have permanent effect on the level of GDP. So the level of consumption is actually different between the two economies.
And consumption is also different, right? So this means that consumption increases as much as GDP, but consumption over GDP doesn't increase.
Got it. Thank you both.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm almost done. So then this is very nice, but I didn't have time to show you, but consumption tariff actually have a contractionary effect on the model and also in the data. And here we did a regression of, but this is not like most of the presented. So I don't want to hold it because of this, but the model we find interesting implies like a contraction effect of consumption tariffs. If you increase only tau C, these are the input responses. And in the data, we find something similar for 14.6 countries. So there are only a few countries that we can do that. Okay. And then just to conclude, because I ran out of time, how financial, we started with this question, how does financial development impact the gains of trailization? I show you first some input responses. Financial development matters when tariff on capital goods are reduced. It increases long-run growth, increases speeds up the transition, and leads to higher welfare gains. Now, productive and wealthy agents benefit most irrespective of financial development. And the gains are more equally distributed in financial developed economy. When we look at Colombia in the way we did it, right? So with the caveats that it has, trailization explains a sizable share of observed growth. It would have been higher if Colombia had been financially developed at the time. And we do also in the paper other types of trailization, tau C, tau KC, like we do a bilateral trailization to compare with other papers, right? Or type of literature. What is robust is financial development leads to a faster transition and larger welfare gains. Yeah, and that's it. So I'm happy to stay and discuss, but I don't want to hold you.
Okay, great. No, now we'll just open up for continue on the conversation. Questions, comments, go ahead and unmute and jump in.
Yeah, so David, I think it's super interesting. One thing that we were discussing with Michael on the chat is that at the same time, most likely there was a liberalization of the capital controls, at least if it's anything like what happened in Chile, like previous to the inflows and previous to the sudden stop, you were relaxing this stuff a little bit. And that could rationalize that extra shock that you need on consumption, because those are basically capital inflows that are arriving to your economy. So that's one thing that I think it could be interesting. It might help you discipline that other exogenous shock that you have there. The other thing that I find interesting is to try to decompose the effect between what's permanent and what not. One option is with this portfolio cost as in Nomair and Terre, because that's going to get you the pin down the long run level of debt. And the only effect is going to come from a faster transition. It's not that I don't think that these things should have permanent effect, but it will help you a little bit to understand how much is coming purely from the transition and how much is coming from the final steady state.
So can I just add two things? So one, I start from the end. So I think something that I wasn't very clear. So how we do the exercise at this point, we're planning to do it in a different way. The shocks are permanent, right? So it's not because of what you say that this is not stationary. It's just that the R stays below. So we shock this, we match the sequence, and then the R stays below in the long run. So it's a different state. So I don't think it's due to the adjustment cost. The other way to do this exercise, to do these shocks, to go back slowly to the, there is a lot of freedom there, right? But to go back slowly to the initial state. I think that it was my fault. I wasn't very clear about how we did, right? So we shocked. We choose the shocks in the first four periods, but then we left them there. Okay, that's one. And the second one is regarding the other point, I think it's very interesting. So we try to capture that with these theta shocks. And actually, if you look at credit over GDP in Colombia, it increased a lot from 0.24 to 0.33 by 1998. And these shocks allow us, and the increase in interest rate, to capture some of that. So if you observe credit over GDP, I didn't show you in this model, it also increases. It doesn't increase as much, but it also increases quite a bit, right? Credit over GDP. And that's a way that we thought also to discipline this sort of shock that we haven't done yet. But it's kind of a nice validation of what we are doing. We can do, instead of such a large increase in interest rate, we could look at the theta, right? And what I think Cecilia and Dorian wanted is like an increase in financial development. And that would look a bit like that. We could match it to the increase in credit over GDP.
So can I chip in on the discussion of capital controls? In that, Felipe, the experience of Colombia is a little different from these other countries that instituted the whole Washington consensus package. In that, in the book on by Sebastian Landwards that I recommended is really good in describing that. Essentially, what happened in Colombia is that because of the drug wars and an assassination shortly before the elections, Gaviria was propelled to the front of the election race when he wasn't even a candidate, just 3 months before. He won on a platform of the Washington consensus types of reforms. The first thing he did was liberalize the trade very abruptly. And as a result, imports, and it was a unilateral trade liberalization, imports to GDP increased, the real exchange rates appreciated, and the industry associations essentially blocked all other reforms that he wanted to implement. So the labor market, capital reforms, and capital control removals that are usually accompanying these trade liberalizations are to much smaller extent present in Colombia. So that's why Colombia is deemed as the cleaner trade liberalization episode relative to these other countries.
Oh, cool. Thanks. We have to look in more detail, probably.
Okay, so we know also from the documents by World Bank that kind of they also were recommending actually financial liberalization. So many of you were asking about, you know, changes in theta, and they were complaining that there wasn't that much financial liberalization, that the banking sector was still highly regulated, there were investment restrictions on the banks. So, you know, yes, that's interesting experiment to kind of look at the complementarities between financial liberalization and trade liberalization. But in Colombia, it seems like, as Cecilia was saying, you know, they didn't implement those reforms as much as the World Bank was pushing them. And that was one of the complaints, and it was one of the reason why World Bank was saying that the gains from trade won't be as big as they could be from those reforms. But yeah, but we should look more about, and we have here a quote which David had to skip because of time constraints. But we should look more into those other reforms, because yeah, they were going on. There was also a period of reforms going on before trade liberalization, because they started reforming since I think 85. We should know a bit more about the sequence of those reforms and what happened.
Yeah, in the end, in our strategy, we try to capture some of this in a reduced form in the shock. So it's like we back out some shocks that maybe are not exactly what they do, but they capture in the aggregate variables the effect that some of these other reforms might be captured. And we try to isolate the effect of the trade liberalization, how we do the exercise, from these other reforms in that sense.
Yeah, and I think that's what Felipe was kind of suggesting, like to kind of link those shocks to. So it would be nice, yeah, if we look into the book that Cecilia was suggesting. So maybe we can kind of link those shocks to some of these reforms. I mean, yeah. Thanks.
So go ahead, Dorian. Go ahead.
No, go. You've been waiting for a while.
No, you go ahead. I'm always here.
To go back to what Felipe said about these two, so that you've got this, your theta, which is about the distribution of investment across the different entrepreneurs in the economy, and then potentially some sort of barriers to capital flows at an aggregate level, which are separate from that. I mean, I think it would be interesting to do those two, but, you know, I, for one, wanted to understand what is the impact of this theta distortion on what the net exports are going to do in response to a trade liberalization, without having sort of some extra sort of financial liberalization shocks. That's why I wanted to see that picture in your sort of model without all these other shocks of what do the net exports do. And that gets back to sort of the question of what is the beta and what is the R, and sort of how, you know, how can I map what's going on in your model into something which I get some intuition from, which is an Iyengar world, or a sort of a Mendoza Quadrini Rias rule where I put two Iyengar worlds together. How does the prediction of your model sort of fit in with what those setups would give you? So I wanted to just encourage you to sort of think about that and presenting those kinds of things, as I think it would help people to understand what are the mechanisms going on with this particular financial friction.
Yeah, I'm gonna, let me just double down on that idea, is that I think it would help me also more talk concretely. I'm just basically saying what Dorian said is like, you have a friction here, and if you could connect that friction directly with what's going on, that would help, I think, a lot in understanding this kind of thing. And then the other thing, like just to step back about the borrowing constraint, is you do have financial liberalization going on when you open a trade, because the borrowing constraint is relaxing. So it would be nice if you could just have like the other constraint without the PKT floating around in there kind of thing. So there it's like purely. And then like the thing is, back to the misallocation, I think like having misallocation statistics, like Laszlo, I mean, I think Laszlo's talked to you guys, but the guy on the market from 2 years ago, I mean, he was kind of pointing out it cuts different ways, and like some guys are relaxed, some guys are hurt. You know, how does that all kind of play out? And I think that's kind of what's missing in the talk right now. So.
Well, some of that is in the, I mean, sorry, to go into the distributional effects, that's a bit in the welfare results. You can see that some people are winning, some people are losing. Those are things we should look into.
The other thing about the financial liberalization constraint, I think that, you know, comments are like, I agree with you, Mike, but that one I would have to disagree, because I don't think about it as financial liberalization. It's just that, you know, it's cheaper to buy capital. I mean, you know, yes, it acts like it's equivalent to, you know, it acts similarly to change in theta, but the amount you borrow is the same. It's just, you know, now the capital is cheaper because you can buy those goods from abroad cheaper way. So, I mean, we can kill the channel. We can, you know, set the PK there to one and see what happens. But
the positive aspect of the paper, I don't care. But the thing is, the normative part about like, or just like, not nor the how that constraint is exactly operating, I think mm-hmm. that's the what Dorian and I'm gonna call it the Minnesota view that right now is this. So
just to jump into this discussion, so two things. One is that the price of capital has two effects, the one that what Mike was saying, and also I think both Mikes. So the other effect is in the borrowing constraint. So we could kill here basically in the borrowing constraint. So it could be cheaper, but then we have like another ad hoc borrowing constraint where D is less than theta times the capital. And I think that would capture some of this effect. The other point is regarding misallocation, yeah, we talked to Laszlo. Also this paper when we started many years ago, it was about measuring misallocation. We were measuring, but we're looking only at steady state. And then we started thinking about how to measure misallocation across to have measure of misallocation through a transition. And there is where, at some point it changed the directions, the paper, right? But we have some measures that we constructed at some point, and we were looking at that at some point.
But I think this is, I mean, it's not to belabor my point about this, but this kind of goes back to Bhagwati had this thing back in the 60s talking about, you know, when you liberalize to trade, does it, in a second best economy, is it pushing it towards or away from the first best? And then that's why I think this is kind of, I mean, I'm totally on board. These are interesting economies to think about that, but like getting at that idea of like, and that's actually back to the problem about the constraint thing, is like, there is just this direct channel that pushes it towards you know, it's relaxing the constraint as you open up to trade. So it would be interesting. But I think that's the, I think in these kind of economies, I think that's the way to kind of frame it is trade making the allocation better or not? And then you, but you guys have a second point is when I interact that with a change in financial liberalization, is it making the trade component more potent or not? So.
Thanks.
So can I jump in for a second? So I thought you guys pulled like a big misdirect on us in the sense that you showed us this really cool stuff in the beginning about like financially liberalized, financially developed and less financially developed in terms of like these transition paths. And then you didn't really come back to it. Like, and then we got bogged down in thinking about like Colombia and like each one of us has a different like history and story. And I think you guys are never going to win doing that. But I think if you'd come back at the end to sort of say, all right, let's look at like, can the model kind of match the transition paths that we sort of identified from the data for like the typical liberalizations, that, you know, that's like a new fact. And, you know, you can kind of break down like what features do we need in the model to sort of get those differences. So, I mean, I like looking at Colombia, but you guys have some interesting new facts that I hadn't seen before. And you didn't really kind of tell us that you could kind of explain them. And so I would have liked to kind of see you guys circle back around to that. And maybe that was there in the back part, but it wasn't like directly there. So just a suggestion.
Thank you. So we thought about this. So I agree. So a different way of doing the exercise, try to quantify with respect to the first few fields that we show in the cross country.
Yeah.
The problem we have with that is that, of course, I mean, there are many other things going on and thinking in Colombia, we can get closer to what happened in different ways. Sure, not everybody will agree with the way we do it. And also, okay, so and why that might be important, because if you look at the magnitudes, and you compare it with the impulse responses that we had, like the magnitude is very different of the trade liberalization. The trade elasticity that we're getting is much smaller than what we observe in the data.
Yep.
So one way would be to try to discipline the model to have a higher trade elasticity for the effect of trade liberalization and then increase the theta and compare the effect of financial development. That's something we thought about. But the thing is that there are, so those fields I showed you at the beginning show some correlation, but there are many things going on, and with Colombia we can kind of split it.
But you guys had lots. You guys had lots of controls in there in those figures, right? So in some sense, I mean, I don't know how many controls you have, but in some sense, you're controlling for some stuff. And when you go to like one individual country, there's just a lot of kind of institutional knowledge. And if you basically said, hey, those figures survive for like with all of the kind of extra controls I put in, then I you can kind of just start off and say, hey, let me look at two economies that are kind of like the average financially developed and average kind of like less developed country. And then, you know, let me trace out the transition path from the liberalization. I would have thought that had been like a compelling wrap up, but not that what you didn't do was like compelling, but it kind of went in a little bit of a different direction. And then we all have like our suggestions for like, you know, what we know about Colombia, right? I don't know.
No, thank you. Probably we'll end up doing both, maybe. Or I don't know. We have to think more. But that's something that we thought and we haven't done yet, quantitatively, right? Qualitatively, the model does generate some of those responses, yeah. But not quantitatively.
Yeah. Can I make one last comment? I was like shocked that the welfare gains were so small until I realized that you guys have like beta equal to 0.8. And so I think like the way you model the beta is going to be really important. And I think, you know, you may want to kind of think about like different ways of modeling how people discount consumption, because in some sense, like, I don't care, you know, with beta 0.8, I don't care about the steady state. Pretty quickly it's, you know, that thing goes to zero with the, even with beta 0.9, it's you know, pretty fast, but at 0.8, it's super fast, right? Twice as fast. So I think you may want to think a little bit more about that in terms of your quantification. Or you could have told Felipe, hey, the steady state doesn't matter in these numbers, so let's not even worry about that. So
Can I, before you ask the first part of the question, I just want to reinforce what George said, because I think that's a super interesting comment. Is what, at the end of the day, what are the micro moments that you used? Because you keep on saying that you had firm level data from Colombia. What did you exploit in the firm, firm data that was so critical?
I mean, these are sort of standard, but from the micro data, we got the share of exporter, the export domestic size premium, and the R1 of total sales. I think those are the ones from the... okay, and then the share of intermediate inputs are there. Also, they look like in the data. We look at those in the data. But other than that, yeah, it's a great moment. So maybe we can do something at the grade. Again, we thought about that. We go step by step because it's, each of these is quite a lot of work, but it's interesting.
Is there any, who is your example of like a financially developed unilateral trade liberalization that was in your data? Is there somebody that you could kind of like, you know, play off Colombia and look at like the differential experiences, kind of like Yargi did with his paper on you know, labor adjustment frictions and liberalizations? Is it Uruguay? Is it is there some way of kind of tracing out the different dynamics that would be useful?
So what you're suggesting, if I understand correctly, is like, okay, an alternative way is to compare Colombia with one of the countries that are there in the cross-country data is financially developed. That's a good idea. Thanks.
Another, this is a completely different, but another idea is, I don't know if you guys know this paper by Oleg and Ben Moll's paper on optimal development policies. And they basically had this kind of framework very similar to like what you guys have set up. They don't think they have trade in there at all, but they had this idea that what you'd want to do is you want to kind of like repress the workers to allow the constrained, you know, firms build up capital and get away from the constraint. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? Or no, I'm looking at Fernando. Look at that paper. And that might be a way to think about maybe it's a separate issue, but how policies like that might facilitate a better trade liberalization or not.
Yeah, I mean, those are interesting. I mean, we're not doing optimal policy, but I think, so even to get at the question of, you know, if we get closer to the first best or not. Yeah, I mean, we'll look into that. And of course, looking at the optimality of these policies, of course. Yeah,
and it's kind of interesting. It's like, what would, you know, because you have in your mind, maybe I just liberalize the financial sector, but you could have done something else. And then they have a concrete idea about what that something else may exactly look like. And
thanks.